One of the household questions in The Clown Show by Nathan Oakley is, any evidence of R? They keep asking this question over and over again, although R has been demonstrated over and over again. But I'll give it another try. In my previous video, I showed the reciprocal zenith measurements that gave strong evidence that the world cannot be flat. These measurements were taken from one point to seven other points at different distances. When we plot the measured angles at those points relative to the vertical on a flat plane and extend the lines downward, we can see that they more or less meet at one point, straight beneath the first observer point. If the Earth were flat and horizontal would be the same direction everywhere, the vertical should be the same everywhere too. All the verticals should be parallel and never meet at one point. This is not the case, as the reciprocal zenith measurements plotted on a flat plane show here. So, the Earth cannot be flat. The Earth must be curved. But would it be possible to show that this curve must be close to a circle and derive the radius of the Earth using just those reciprocal zenith measurements? If the verticals are all radii of a circle, then we can calculate the radius of that circle. The distance between two points multiplied by the ratio between the full circle, 360 degrees, and measured angle divided by 2 times pi gives us the distance to the point where both local verticals meet. This distance is the radius of the circle on which the local verticals are perpendicular to the local horizontals, that is, the local tangent to the circle. But wait a minute, this calculation presumes a sphere. That's an absolute no-go with Nathan Oakley. He hasn't understood that every hypothesis basically begins with an if-then statement, but that doesn't stop him from shouting, "begging the question fallacy," or something along those lines. Alright then, let's presume a flat Earth, a presumption that doesn't seem to alarm Oakley. In that case, the distance between the observer and the point where the vertical of the other observer crosses his own vertical can be described as R equals the distance between the observers divided by the tangent of the reciprocal zenith angle. And lo and behold, the results are the same. 6956, 7032, 7125, 7167, 7201, 7155, and 7198 kilometers respectively. These values are all in the same order of magnitude, so all verticals cross around the same point. Flurfers have no explanation for this fact. If the Earth were flat, all verticals should be parallel, and parallel lines don't cross by definition. Globers, on the other hand, have one. They call this point the center of a sphere. However, they are all larger than the general accepted radius of the Earth of 6,371 kilometers. The deviation is around 9 to 13%, and this requires an explanation. We must remember that the measurements are a result of observations in real life. These observations are subject to visual limitations, of which atmospheric refraction is the most important one. Standard refraction makes the Earth look flatter than it is in reality. I explained this in my previous video, but I will do it again. Under normal atmospheric conditions, light bends downwards, which will result in reciprocal zenith measurements that are slightly smaller than in reality. This makes the sum of the zenith angles still larger than 180 degrees, but this excess is smaller than could be expected. When the Earth were flat, these angles should add up to 180 degrees, so the closer the sum of the zenith angles approaches 180 degrees, the flatter the Earth would seem to be. So, we must take atmospheric conditions into account. The easy way is to apply the 7 over 6 ratio from Mick West's curve calculator. This leads to a calculated Earth radius of 6027, 6143, 6107, 6143, 6172, 6133, and 6170 kilometers respectively, an underestimating of the radius by around 3 to 6%. A more accurate way is to use Walter Bisling's curve calculator. I calculated the refraction angle for the different observations from the observer height of 2533 meters for the different distances. This refraction angle works both ways, so it influences both zenith angles. This leads to a correction of the resulting angle between two verticals of 0.04, 0.05, 0.097, 0.117, 0.094, 0.066 and 0.086 degrees. Calculation of the radius in this way gives these results: 6,665, 6,663, 6,424, 6,330, 6,508, 6,660 and 6,559 kilometers respectively. A deviation from the real value of 6,371 kilometers of around minus 0.6 to 4.5%. The method Walter Bisling is remarkably accurate. When the refraction index K is adjusted just a little bit from standard, 0.14, to medium, 0.19, the outcome would be spot on. This, of course, is not proof of a spherical Earth. However, it is strong evidence that shows that the Earth cannot be flat. It points in the direction of a spherical Earth with a radius of 6,371 kilometers. What a wonderful thing this reciprocal zenith measurement is. It debunks the Earth being flat. It debunks there not being curvature. It debunks there not being a radius. It liberates us from the need to take all kinds of nonsensical, simile, scientific pseudo-explanations for phenomena that are perfectly explained within the spherical Earth model series. And no, we don't live in a model, but we most certainly live on a spherical Earth that can be depicted as the spherical Earth model. Nathan Oakley, eat your heart out.